In this module on polymers, we want to talk about three phenomena: crystallization, melting, and glass transition. So let's start with crystallization. All crystallization is the process by which crystalline polymer regions are produced upon cooling from a liquid melt. Remember that crystalline polymer regions means the regions in the polymer that has an ordered and repeated structure, not just anywhere in the polymer. It has to be that ordered component. Crystallization occurs via nucleation and growth processes, just as we talked about for metals. And it follows the typical Avrami equation that we also talked about back in chapter 6. And so this I'll remind you, along with the graph, that Y here in the Avrami equation is the normalized fraction that's crystallized. T obviously is time, and then K and N are just empirically fitted constants. The only difference between the use of the Avrami equation for polymers and the use in the Avrami equation for metals is that for polymers, we know that we can never get to 100% crystallized, so we use a normalized fraction where we normalize by the maximum amount that can be crystallized. So 1 in this case doesn't really equal 100% crystallization. It just equals 100% of what's possible to crystallize. So that's crystallization. The next phenomena also is relevant to crystalline polymers. It's the process by which a crystalline polymer is going to be transformed into a viscous liquid with some random molecular structure. This occurs at what's called the melting temperature, not surprisingly. And all I'm showing you here in this video below is just a repair being done to some polymer part where they're melting this polymer to fix this hole that they had in there. But there are some differences between polymer melting and what we're used to in terms of metal melting. The first is that polymer melting takes place over a range of temperatures. So in metals, it had a very specific temperature. In polymers, it takes place over a range. And the reason for that is because, remember, we talked again in the previous lectures about polydispersity, the fact that any given polymer has some distribution of molecular weights inside of it. And those molecular weights control, at least they affect, the melting temperature. And so because we have that variability of molecular weights, we also have a corresponding variability of temperature ranges over which melting takes place. And this is going to be, maybe a few degrees C. It's not huge, but it's there, and it's something that's not present in metals. Another thing that's important to remember about polymers is that the melting temperature depends on the specimen history. We can't just look at a polymer and know exactly what its melting temperature will be. The reason is because thicker crystalline portions, these lamella that form, and we talked about this again last lecture, those lead to a higher melting temperature. So the history with which the polymer was formed to create these crystalline lamella also affect the melting temperature. This one's not so different from metals. We did talk about alloying potentially changing transformation temperatures in steels. In this case, any sort of impurities we have in the crystallites is going to decrease the melting temperature, and so that's something to be aware of. And then the final difference would be that the melting temperature in polymers is a function of heating rate. The higher the rate, the higher the melting temperature. And the reason is, remember, polymers have to move. If you want them to form an amorphous viscous liquid, then they have to move from their crystalline state, and that takes time. So if you heat it up fast enough, well, you're gonna get to a higher temperature before that process occurs. And so you'll see that melting temperature is not a single number. It actually depends on the time that the rate that you're applying the heat over. Okay, so moving on now from talking about crystalline portions of the polymer, let's talk about the amorphous portions of the polymer. And that's where we get into this glass transition temperature, or glass transition is the phenomena. And it's just the process by which an amorphous polymer region is going to form first a rubbery material and then finally a rigid solid upon cooling from some liquid melt. And the transition from rubbery to rigid occurs at what's called the glass transition temperature. And it's important also to remember that this process can reverse upon heating. So we can cool it down to get to this solid region, and we can heat it up to get to this viscous region. And I'm showing you this in a plot to the right here. This is showing you the relaxation modulus. Remember, we talked about that last lecture as a function of temperature. And of course, it varies by 7 orders of magnitude. At the low temperature end, we have a very stiff, glassy behavior, rigid. We move through what's called a leathery region into the rubbery region, and then finally we start to viscous flow. But this transition from glassy to rubbery, so when we sit in the leathery region, that is represents the glass transition temperature. Now that's a little bit nebulous, so we actually define it more formally. So let's just briefly talk about how we determine the glass transition temperature and the melting temperature. So what I'm showing you here is the specific volume as a function of temperature. This red curve is for a glassy material. The green curve is for a semicrystalline solid, and the blue curve is for a crystalline solid. And what we observe is that we have a liquid up to here at high temperature. As we cool down, for a glassy material, there is no melting temperature, remember? It just becomes more and more solid, remaining amorphous, just like a liquid is. And then at the glass transition temperature, there is a change in the slope, and that change in slope location gives us the glass transition temperature. In contrast, for a semicrystalline solid, where we're going to have some crystallization, we cool down, we get to the melting temperature, and then there's a step jump in the specific volume. So that's distinct from this slope change. It's actually a step jump. Then we cool down, and then we see a slope change as the amorphous regions of that semicrystalline solid go through the glass transition temperature. So that's how we formally define it. We look at the specific volume, or you could write that as the density, obviously, too. Of this curve, only the top two are valid for polymers because we can't create a crystalline solid with a polymer, not 100% crystalline anyway. So every polymer is either going to be glassy or amorphous, or it's going to be semicrystalline where it has crystalline and amorphous components. How do we use these temperatures? This is just real brief, but usually the glass transition temperature defines the upper use temperature for a glassy polymer. So to give you an example, my area of expertise, or at least one of them, is in epoxy carbon fiber composites and epoxy glass fiber composites. And we always want to use our epoxy below the glass transition temperature in those applications. So TG, backing up, epoxy is a glassy polymer. So we want to use those epoxies below the glass transition temperature, so it represents some upper bound. In contrast, if you're working with a semicrystalline polymer, then TG typically is going to define the lower bound temperature, and TM, the melting temperature, is going to be the upper use temperature that you'd want. Okay, finally, I want to talk about what kinds of things in the polymer can affect TG and TM. Probably the most important is that with increasing chain stiffness, both glass transition temperature and melting temperature increase. So we can increase the chain stiffness in a few ways. The first is by the presence of bulky side groups. So we just make it harder to move when we introduce those bulky side groups. Similarly, we can add the presence of polar groups or polar side groups. Those also stiffen the chain. And then finally, we can add aromatic or double bonds in the chain, and those also stiffen the chain. The other feature, both glass transition temperature and melting temperature increase with increasing molecular weight. So that's what this curve on the right is showing. Here's a molecular weight on a log scale on the x-axis, and here's temperature. This blue curve represents the glass transition temperature. So you can see as we increase molecular weight, our glass transition temperature is going up, and we see a similar behavior for the melting temperature. So think higher molecular weight, higher TG and TM. One thing to be aware of as well that only affects TG is that highly cross-linked polymers have an elevated TG over those that are less cross-linked. The reason I don't say anything about melting temperature is that, remember, melting temperature is only relevant to crystalline polymers, and heavily cross-linked polymers can't be crystalline. So, but if you have something that's heavily cross-linked, you're going to elevate the TG. And in fact, you can sometimes measure, get a qualitative measure of cross-linking by actually measuring TG for different polymer systems. That sort of is the highlights of these three phenomena: crystallization, melting, and glass transition.